Good evening. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of November 5th, 2015. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight. I'll be presiding tonight. As per our custom, we're going to start with our public comments session. And the public comment is an opportunity for anyone to come and speak on any topic for a period duration no longer than 3 minutes, recognizing that our council rules preclude any comments from the council. We can't respond to questions. It's your turn. You'll get to hear us talk a whole lot afterwards. And what we ask you to do when I call your name, if you'd step up, repeat your name, and tell us your address, and then the clock will start, and it's projected up there, and you can see how you're doing. And first up, we have Hildegard Friedman, please.
This is Hildegard. Hildegard Friedman at 413-582-7081. I am a bit of a dragon slayer who has been running salons off and on for 30 years. Indigenously Bostonian, but of late in the Berkshires. I'm just newly in Northampton. Brains of the Berkshires, which was an extraordinarily yuppie salon. That's not what I intend to do here. Brains of Litchfield County, which met at the White Hart, which former home of Henry Ford of Ford Motor Company. The Brains of the Berkshires met at the Cromwell, which was also yuppie. And then packed ballrooms at Guest Quarter Suite Hotel in Boston. What I'm hoping to do here is not a salon of the Enlightenment as Voltaire. It is not the Algonquin Club, which started the New Yorker magazine. I'm proposing an endeavor of community connections in which people come together, for example, the Veterans Administration, or even the veterans of foreign war, or even people in Northampton housing projects, with the general public, and communicate with one another, and have an opportunity to voice issues with an entirely different ambiance. And I am a dragon slayer. I'm looking forward to meeting with you, and I'm very much looking forward to joining and becoming a part, an active part of your city council. And I thank you for giving me this prize opportunity.
Thank you very much. Did Roger leave? Roger left.
Mm-hmm. I saw him outside.
Okay. Paige Brody, please.
Thanks. My name is Paige Brody. I live on William Street, and I'm here representing the Naugatuck Community School. I want to thank you, first of all, for allowing some very thoughtful discussion of the Fiker Scroll RFP and lease at the last council meeting, and I wanted to update you. As the council urged at the last meeting, we've reached out to the school committee and various members thereof and have not been granted a forum to be able to dialogue about the terms of the lease. Several members we've spoken to were under the impression that this issue should be taken up by their budget and property subcommittee, but we've had no luck with that or getting a meeting with them either. We were able to get a meeting with the mayor and the superintendent yesterday. They made it clear that they don't have any interest in negotiating the terms of the lease and the RFP. So if something major did happen on the building during our new lease, we thought that our offer to put up the first repair dollars and then have the Fiker School reserve fund tapped was reasonable to a landlord, but the mayor and superintendent aren't willing to entertain that. It sounds like they have other intentions for the funds, and they feel that the only course of action is for to let the current RFP and lease just continue to run its course. So we are essentially picking our poison at this point. So we either have to close next June because we'll have no lease, or take this somewhat terrible lease that leaves us liable for any major capital expenditures, even though we won't own the building and we'll only have a short-term lease. So those are our two terrible choices right now, but that's the position we're in. And this really is a shame, because I think that the spirit and intention of the school committee still seems to be one of great support for us. They were clear that Northampton can't accommodate the loss of the childcare and preschool spots that we offer working families. But the terms of this RFP and lease really undermine that spirit, because it's so untenable for us. So Nonotech's in a pickle. We feel like our only choice at this point is to let you, again, approve the RFP and lease they submitted, and really just hope, just cross our fingers that we'll have a better opportunity to work together in the next steps to work out something. Our biggest fear all along has been that drawing out this complicated process will really just exhaust them, and that they'll give up on us and, you know, would rather surplus the building back to the mayor. But everyone we've spoken with, including many of you, really agree that that is not a good option for us, and that Nonotech would probably be very much out of luck at that point. So I'm about to do the same very strange thing that you had to do at the last meeting, which is request a yes for approval while shaking my head no, a yes but a no, essentially. This lease and this RFP really put Nonotech in a terrible position, but we feel like we're really trapped, and procedurally this is our only hope for now. So I want to thank you again for all the time you took to thoughtfully deliberate, and if you have any questions, of course, I'll be around and you can recognize me in session. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. Jasper Lapienski.
Hello, I'm Jasper Lapienski. I live at Smith College at 43 West Street. I'm here again to talk about Ridgeview Road. The following definition of moral hazard is from dictionary.com, which is my favorite online reference site. Moral hazard, the risk that an individual or organization will act irresponsibly or recklessly if protected or exempt from the consequences of an action. This is what I was talking about. And the only reason I'm clarifying, by the way, is because from the discussion thereafter, it seemed like, I'm just going to say roughly 8 members of the city council did not fully understand the points I was trying to make. When I said, this is not the same as Center Court or Isabella Street, traditional neighborhood roads that grew up with the city, but rather a quarter mile long massive driveway that leads to 4 gaping mansions constructed on blind faith at the tail end of the housing boom. There were bloated, gigantic mansions being constructed on blind faith at the tail end of the housing boom. That's not controversial. These homes were not being constructed necessarily for wealthy people. We just thought that everyone could afford a 7-bedroom home. But these homes are mansions. Realtor.com and Homes.com list number 65 and number 38 Ridgeview Road as being worth an estimated $637,000 and $739,000 respectively. This is not a home most people listening to this can afford or should be able to afford. And we need a pilot project, but now we're going to use the money. And I said the top 1%, maybe that was a little bit of an exaggeration. There was clear cutting of the forest. A lot of the homes that were planned for there never got built because the housing boom expired before the homes were able to be constructed, which is probably good for those builders. I finished with a question. I'm going to finish with the same question. Do we as a community wish to go out of our way to reward the least sustainable building practices we can possibly imagine? That is what the acceptance of Ridgeview Road tonight will do. The risk that an individual or organization will act irresponsibly or recklessly by building homes that no one can hope to afford if protected or exempt from the consequences of an action, under the assumption that the city will accept the street and that homeowners will not have to take on that additional burden. Just because you work doesn't mean that you're working class. Thanks.
Thank you. That's all I have signed up. Is anyone else interested in speaking at this time? Is that? I don't know.
Guess not.
No one else? Okay. I'm going to ask the assistant to call the roll, please.
Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Councilor Dean.
Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Shara.
Here.
Councilor Spector.
Here.
We have a quorum. Councilor Klein has a business conflict and is absent with an excuse. Before we get, as I said, we have a very long agenda. Before I get to that, I think it's appropriate. It's more than appropriate. I mean, it's required. It's mandatory that to acknowledge the passing of Jim Dossal. Jim Dossal, former council president, former councilor at large, former school committee member, the man who was essentially who knew the entire anatomy of this community and its soul, was a modest individual who actually deeply cared about his community. And he served the community not because he had ambitions or because he was seeking power or even trying to advance an agenda. He served the community because he grew up here, he cherished this place, and he was a paragon of what it means to be a public servant. He actually he served as a model for us, because as a public servant, he gave that position nobility. And his passing, for even folks who didn't know him, is significant. And you can see Jim's mark in every system and every action that we've done since his tenure. In this community, and things that we take for granted, things like the water that flows under our streets. Jim is in large part responsible for these systems. So I would ask you all to join me for a brief moment of silence and acknowledging and thinking of Jim Dossal. Thank you for that. Now we make time for communications from the mayor, and he does indeed have communications.
Good evening, councilors. Thank you, Mr. President, for that recognition. I just had one item, basically to update you on the status of the pilot program. I know that some of you were able to attend some of the town hall meetings, the three town hall meetings I held, I wanted to provide, I actually already passed it out to you. It's part of the final updated PowerPoint presentation that I did, and then we will be putting that up on the web tomorrow. One of the questions that came up a lot was the issue that I had exempted religious institutions from the program. And I talked about that at length at all three of those town hall meetings, including both the legal reasons and then the sort of philosophical reasons for why I had done that. The other question that people had was what did it constitute in terms of property value? So we did a chart, sort of a hypothetical chart, where we basically ran those properties through the same analysis. And so you can see this, you know, it gives you the same analysis, you know, cut off at $1 million, total pilot, and then, you know, what the actual would be at 100%. And again, you see the grand total is $69,600. So I wanted to give you this additional information for those that weren't at the program, at the final program, and also just let folks know that'll be updated to the website. My plan over the next couple of weeks, obviously, is to try to gather all the feedback that I heard at those forums. Continue the meetings that I've been having with the institutions. There are still, I believe, three institutions that I haven't met with. One because of a scheduling issue, and one we may not meet. They may not want to meet with me. And so I'm hoping over the next couple of weeks that I'll get that finalized and, as expected, come back to you on the 19th with some form of a resolution for your consideration. So that's the update. And actually, Mr. President, I was going to ask you, it just seemed to be appropriate, given the moment of silence that you just had, whether it might be appropriate to pull up an order that I have on the agenda, later in the agenda.
Okay. the counselor, all those? I'm seeing a nodding of heads. I'll accept that as a an agreement with you. So that'd be great.
So I wondered if it would be possible. It just seemed to do it now at the beginning.
Sure.
You had already spoken about it. As you correctly pointed out, well, I'll let you read the order first.
Yeah, and I got to find it here.
Sorry about that.
We have a 42-page agenda. This is for the
There it is on the screen. 12. Yeah.
Number 12
coming up. Scrolling down. There it is. Okay. In City Council, November 5th, 2015, upon the recommendation of Mayor David J. Narkowitz, ordered that the Northampton Wastewater Treatment Plant, located at 33 Hockenham Road, Northampton, Massachusetts, is hereby renamed the James M. Dossal Senior Northampton Wastewater Treatment Plant. I'll accept a motion. Put that on the floor.
Second.
Your Honor?
Just wanted, obviously, to echo the comments you made during your moment of silence. Councillor Dostal obviously had a major impact and in particular left a really important mark on this wastewater treatment plant, which he basically was there as it was built from the ground up and was obviously the superintendent of the treatment plant at the end of, retired from the DPW after 42 years as the leader of that system. I'd been in contact with his family in the weeks prior to his passing, and his brother had talked with me about wanting to do something, a park bench or something, some way of remembering him. But in my mind, this seemed like the most appropriate way to remember him and his contribution. And I know some people might think it's strange to have a plant like this named after you, but I think
not Jim.
His family to a person thought that this was the perfect tribute to Jim, and he would be deeply honored. So that when future, generations of folks either drive by or go there to work, that they'll know that Jim Dostal played a really important role in not only that piece of infrastructure, but our whole city's infrastructure system and our politics, as you so eloquently pointed out.
Would this name extend, should the treatment plant I know that at some point the expiration date on that, well, it may have actually already passed on that building, and if we were able to build a new one, would...
Well, there's a lot of upgrades that are needed at the plant. There's definitely a lot of upgrades that are needed and a lot of systems, and I know that there have been public presentations about the capital needs, and we'll be talking about that more in that process, but, the name would stay with the facility, in my view. I don't think we'll be moving the facility anywhere. So the name would certainly stay with the facility. I don't envision us building a brand new plant in my lifetime, but maybe my tenure. Maybe we'll do a massive renovation, but we'll see.
Because certainly I would like this to be memorialized.
Yeah. Well, certainly the Northampton Wastewater Treatment Plant, it would carry with it in the future, yeah.
Any other comments, Councilor LaBarge?
Mayor, I want to thank you for thinking of doing this honor for James Dostal. I just think that's where it belongs. I mean, he put in over 48 years?
If you combine all of the different types of service, the BPW and the, it's probably over 50. Certainly 42 as an employee, and then 10 as a school committee member, 10 as a city councilor.
Well, I think this is a great honor for Jim Dostal and for the family also. Thank you.
And I know our DPW director is here. I don't know whether he would want to add anything to this or I did speak with the director before I brought this order forward, and I don't know if you would.
Ed, would you like to speak to this?
When the mayor called me about this last Friday, I said I thought it was quite an honor for Jim to have this named after him and give him my blessing. So I'm 100% behind it. Just the council's aware of that.
I had no doubt about that. So. Any other comments from the council? Any other discussion? Thank you, Ned. I know we'll be seeing you again. Any other comments?
No.
Roll call, please.
Councilor
Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Sherriff?
Yes.
Counselor Spector?
Yes.
Counselor Adams?
Yes.
That passes unanimously and will be revisited at the next council meeting for the second reading. Thank you. We have an update from the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances regarding the 2016-2017 council meeting.
We just want to thank all the counselors who made the time to come to our first working session. We got about halfway through the document, I think, and reviewed it. We are going to need to take another evening and schedule another meeting to finish going through the document the rest of the way. So perhaps when we conclude the meeting tonight, we can check our schedules and see when people would be available to spend another evening. I think we can get through it in one more night. And get it back here on the floor for a final debate. There was, you know, considerable, I think, consensus. It was a good process. It worked well. And after another meeting, we should be able to get it back here on the floor to debate the remaining issues during a council meeting. So thank everybody for having made the time, and we made good progress. And
yes, can I just ask a quick question, because I wasn't present? Did you just go straight through the document, or did you do were any amendments under?
We went through the document from the beginning, as I said, got about halfway through. There were several different versions of it, so we would refer to the various versions to get the state of the art on there. And in some instances, you know, where there was total consensus, we made, you know, minor changes or corrected spelling or punctuation or that sort of thing. But I wouldn't say, and do you agree, we didn't really make any substantive changes to anything as we went through, and mostly what we did was, of the several different versions, we agreed, I think, in some instances, which was the best of those and included it. But after one more working session, we'll distribute what is then the state of the art and then bring it here for full discussion. So nothing's gonna, you know, nothing, the document is not gonna to be approved without it being distributed in its final form after the working group and coming here to the council to be reviewed again at this level. So if you're unable to make the working sessions, you'll see the final product, and that will get the full treatment here at a regular council meeting before it becomes our rules. So,
yeah, essentially, we sifted through it and red flagged things that might be subject to amendment or change, mm-hmm. and incorporating your comments as well, mm-hmm. Councilor LeBarge's as well.
Yeah, we did. We actually. If we were on an item that you had written us about, we read your opinion along with the various versions of whatever we're talking about. So it was there, and it will return here in its reviewed form for the full treatment at this body.
Thank you for the update. And I noticed that I skipped the agenda item that minutes of the October 1st, 2015 council meeting.
Move to
accept a motion for approval on that, please.
Second.
Any discussion on the minutes? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Now we have the minutes of committees, Committee of Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances meeting of September 14th, 2015, the Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Culture, and Recreation meeting minutes of September 21st, 2015, and the Finance Committee meeting minutes, I knew I wasn't going to get through it, of October 1st, 2015.
Move to approve them.
Moving them
as a group.
Is there a second? Okay. Any discussion on these? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? That the meetings are approved. The minutes are approved. Sorry. Now we come to these are for referral appointments. Refer to the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances. As first, we have the Council on Aging, Teresa Dunn at 46 Finn Street, Northampton. The term starts April 2015, expires June 2018, and this is a reappointment. Next up, we have Barbara Fognaroli of 25 Landy Avenue in Northampton. The term to start April 2015, expiring June 2018, also a reappointment. Maureen Sinkowitz, 364B Hatfield Street and Laurel Ridge Apartments in Northampton, with a term starting April 2015, expiring June 2018, also a reappointment. James Spencer, 12 Middle Street in Florence, again, same term, also a reappointment. Melissa Einberg of 388 Berths Pit Road in Northampton. This term starts September 2015, expires June 2016. This is a new appointment to fill the expired term of Patricia Healy. And then we have Jerry Ann Butler, 46 Autumn Drive of Florence, and the term begins November 2015, expires June 2018. This is also a new appointment to fill the vacancy left by the unexpired term of Diane Soler. Accept a motion for the referral?
Move to take it as a group.
So you want to move them as a group to refer to ordinance?
Yes.
Second.
Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Next up, we have the Disabilities Commission. This is Letitia Ward, 66 Willow Street in Florence. The term starts November 2015, expires June 2018. And this is a new appointment to fill the unexpired term of Tori Eklund. Accept a motion for referral?
Move to refer it out.
Second.
To rules, orders, appointments.
Yeah.
Ordinance.
Got it. And it's been seconded by Councilor Adams. Thank you very much. All those in favor of the referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? This is for the Arts Council as a correction to appointment term. Esther White, 17 Summer Street in Northampton. The term starts January 2015, expires June 2018, and it's a new appointment. This appointment was approved by the City Council on January 16, 2015. However, the term was incorrect. And this is to amend the appointment term from January 2015 to June 2018. So this would not require referral. So
okay, so move to amend it.
Okay,
I'll second.
Any discussion on this correction? All those in favor of the proper term for Esther White to serve in the Arts Council, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Now we have the Community Preservation Commission. Julia Chevin, 8 Cosmian Avenue in Florence. The term starts September 2015 to June 2018. This is Parks and Recreation's representative, a new appointment from the Parks and Recreation Commission. We repeated that. Glenn is Parks and Recreation. Glenn Connolly of 49 Platinum Circle, Florence. The term starts June 2015, expires June 2018. And this is a reappointment. And that's not for referral. These are for referral as well. Okay.
Make a motion to refer.
For
second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. And last on these appointments, we have Transportation and Parking Commission. We have Jamie Albro Fisher of 50 Manhattan Street in Northampton. The term starts November 2015, expires June 2017. This is a new appointment to fill the vacancy left by James Lowenthal. And also Richard Cooper, 136 South Main Street in Florence. The term begins May 2015, expires June 2018. And this is a reappointment. So
move to refer.
The motion's made to refer. And a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, now we get to the dark heart of this meeting. Okay. Pam wants me to note that all those appointments have been referred and will not be eligible for discussion that ordinance until December 14th. So,
quick.
Seven-day rule. Your charter. So, thank you for that note.
December.
14th. Now we as our tradition, we recess the council meeting and move into finance committee meeting, which we're all in attendance here. But I pass the gavel figuratively to Councilor Murphy, who is the chair of that committee.
Thank you. Pam, would you call the roll of finance, please?
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Lavarge.
Present.
Councilor Shira.
Here.
Thank you. The first thing we need to do is approve our minutes of our October 15th meeting. Do we have a motion on that?
Make a motion.
Second.
Any additions, corrections? Are we good with it? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? No, thank you. All right, now on to financial orders. The first thing we have is an easement on land of the Northampton Wireworks Office of Business and Technology. This is the first reading of this easement. Whereas the Department of Public Works, Northampton, has proposed to undertake a drainage improvement project on Hinckley Street, and whereas the project will require certain drainage and outflow easements on land of Northampton Wireworks Office Business and Technology Center, LLC. Now, therefore, it be ordered that the City Council authorizes the acquisition by gift purchase, eminent domain, or otherwise, the following permanent easements. Permanent easement one, a permanent easement in, on, or over certain parcel of land shown as easement area containing 19,587 square feet on a plan entitled Plan of Land in Northampton, Massachusetts, surveyed for the City of Northampton by Heritage Surveys, Inc., dated April 22, 2015. The purpose of this easement is to permit the grantee to install, maintain, repair, and replace one or more drainage pipes, a drainage outfall, and an access road in order to reconfigure the drainage area being conveyed down Hinckley Street to enter and remain upon the easement area by footer with vehicles and equipment for the purpose of installing, maintaining, repairing, and replacing said drainage pipes, outfall, and access road, and to grade as necessary in order to maintain the stability of the easement area. And permanent easement number two, a permanent easement in, on, and over a certain parcel of land shown as existing drainage channel on a plan entitled Hinckley Street by the City of Northampton Department of Public Works Engineering Department, dated May 2015. The purpose of this easement is to discharge water from the drainage outfall and to maintain an unobstructed flow of water from the southern boundary of the easement area described in permanent easement number one above to the Mill River south, and to enter and remain upon the easement area by foot with vehicles and equipment for the purpose of maintaining the easement area to assure unobstructed flow of water to the Mill River. And further, that $6,900 be awarded as pro tanto damages for the taking of the easement described above, which sum shall be appropriated from the stormwater enterprise. We have a motion, Bonnie?
So make a motion.
Second. We want Mr. Huntley is here. Do we want him to? We have questions in finance or anyone?
This is the order that I had pulled from the previous agenda, which had been I guess it would be described as that was more of an unfriendly taking. This is
It got friendly.
We've had some conversations we were able to finally make contact with the owner, and the city solicitor working with their attorney. So that's why it's being brought back forward to you in a different form. So, but Mr. Hinckley can speak. Mr. Huntley can speak. Can speak about the Hinckley Street outflow and why we need to have this easement to complete the Hinckley Street project.
So, Mr. Huntley. Evening again. This is a critical element for the Hinckley Street reconstruction project. We actually currently have a small diameter outfall there, but we have no easement for it. It was probably put back in the 1910s or 1920s. With this project, we're actually diverting about 26 acres of watershed that will be taken out and be relieved to the lower Elm Street drain system by doing this work. So large diameter pipes, it's a 36-inch diameter pipe, and we've been working on this easement for well in half a good year to get this. And like I said, the Hinckley reconstruction project can't move forward without this. I did make a note when I downloaded this from the website. The order taking talks about temporary easements. I just want to make sure that Scribner error is corrected.
Yeah, everything here is permanent easement.
I heard that, but that's not what came down off the website on the order.
I'm reading it off the website as well, so if it's any consolation.
Okay. Looking really permanent to us.
Yeah. Okay, just wanted to make sure.
And this is going to be great because the poor people on Hinckley Street have been waiting for, 30 years to get their street redone, and this is the last, the last component of that.
Last big hurdle.
Great. Any questions for Mr. Huntley or any discussion in finance? No, or of anyone? All right. Then, all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Now we have several street acceptance orders that I'll go through for you. The first one is Warner Row in Leeds. Whereas a petition has been duly filed to lay out and accept Warner Row as a public way, and whereas the petition has been referred to the Planning Board and to the Public Works Commission, formerly known as the Board of Public Works, and whereas the Public Works Commission has held and duly noticed a public hearing on the petition to lay out and accept the public way, and whereas the Planning Board provided no recommendation and Public Works Commission voted to recommend laying out and accepting Warner Row as a public way, now therefore it be ordered that the City Council authorizes the acquisition by gift, purchase, eminent domain, or otherwise of an easement in and over parcels of land shown as Warner Row on a plan entitled Plan of Land in Northampton, Massachusetts, Hampshire County, prepared for the City of Northampton, dated January 29, 2014, the purpose of laying out, establishing, and accepting public ways thereon. Further, that the City Council hereby lays out, establishes, and accepts as a public way the parcels to be acquired herein, and further, that no damages shall be payable as a result of any taking authorized herein, and no betterment shall be assessed as a result of laying out, establishing, and accepting such a public way. Do we have a motion in Finance?
Make a motion.
Second? Okay. Any discussion on this?
Yes.
Any questions?
I do have a discussion.
Mr. Huntley?
Yes. Ned, would you have an answer to why the Planning Board didn't make a recommendation on that?
Actually, Carolyn Mish is here, and she tends to be around for, she's hiding in the corner back there. But
I didn't even see you.
Carolyn, can you come up and answer Councilor LaBarge's question about
that?
Do
we need a motion to recognize her?
No.
Okay. Make a motion.
Stab, yeah. I bet she knows.
The Planning Board had a discussion about many of these streets, but there were some of them that they felt that there wasn't really any planning reason per se, one way or the other. They felt like it was more of a City Council policy and public, you know, political decision. So they didn't want to enter into that fray, and they felt they wanted to leave it up to the City Council. So the ones where they made no recommendation, they didn't feel like there was any, you know, necessarily burning planning interest.
On the others, they did make recommendations, so.
There were some, there are some that they've, so there were so many of these streets, and they, in the first wave, they started making recommendations one way or the other. There were some that they felt really didn't make sense to create essentially frontage on which new lots could be carved off of roads or driveways that, you know, never received formal subdivision approval. So there were some clear-cut ones, and then there became some other ones where there historically there had been lots and on them, and public access had been utilized, even though the infrastructure didn't really meet the standards. And so it became a tricky assessment as to, you know, what their decision really was. So yes, they did make some recommendations, and as these continue to come forward, they shifted their assessment over time. So that's all I can say.
Is it safe to say there was no negative, there's no negative connotation to their deciding not to weigh in on this, or?
Right, I mean, they would have voted against it if there was unanimity about that.
So they just chose not to weigh in with no negative implication.
Right.
Any more discussion on this one? All in favor of a positive recommendation of Finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. But the next one is Bright Avenue. Whereas a petition has been duly filed to lay out and accept Bright Avenue as a public way, and whereas the petition has been referred to the Planning Board and to the Public Works Commission, formerly known as the Board of Public Works, and whereas the Public Works Commission held and duly noticed a public hearing on the petition to lay out and accept the public way, and whereas the Planning Board provided no recommendation and Public Works Commission voted to recommend laying out and accepting Bright Avenue as a public way, now therefore it be ordered that the City Council authorizes the acquisition by gift, purchase, eminent domain, or otherwise of an easement in and over parcels of land shown as Bright Avenue on a plan entitled Plan of Land in Northampton, Mass., Hampshire County, prepared for the City of Northampton, dated March 11th, 2014, for the purpose of laying out, establishing, and accepting public ways thereon. Further, the City Council hereby lays out, establishes, and accepts as a public way the parcels to be acquired hereunder, and further, that no damages shall be payable as a result of any taking authorized herein, and no betterment shall be assessed as a result of laying out, establishing, or accepting such public way. We have a motion on this one?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on Bright Avenue or questions for Mr. Huntley?
Nope, because this is the same as the previous one with no recommendation from planning.
Okay. A question?
I suppose it's for Mr. Huntley. I know on Bright Avenue there is a building that has tenants in it, and the owner has put up no parking along, has put up signs that say no parking along the street to try and reserve that for his tenants. I assume if we take this as a public way, that will no longer be allowed.
It would have to be done by ordinance.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Spector,
I just have a general comment. Not on Bright, but I'll get it in here. You have, I believe, four or five more of the streets, and I wonder if the boilerplate language you might skip, or if you'd like to read that each time, but it's the same language.
It's at your
for
pleasure.
Every street, but I, you read it very nicely.
I don't want to shortchange the folks at home, but I'm very happy to shorten the process if you like. So to Bright Avenue, since there's no other discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, the next one is Maple Avenue. I'll just read the beginning of it. Petition has been duly filed to accept Maple Avenue as a public way. The petition has been referred to the Planning Board and Public Works Commission. Public Works Commission held a duly noted public hearing of the petition to lay out the public way. Both the Planning Board and the Public Works Commission have recommended laying out and accepting Maple Avenue. So this got approved by both. Do we have a motion on Maple Avenue?
Make a motion.
Second. All right. Any questions or discussion on Maple Avenue in finance? All in favor of a positive recommendation? Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Great. The next one is for Carey Street. Whereas a petition has been duly filed to lay out Carey Street as a public way, and the petition has been referred to Planning Board and Public Works Commission. Whereas the Public Works Commission had a duly noticed public hearing on the petition to lay out, and whereas both the Planning Board and Public Works Commission have recommended laying out and accepting Carey Street as a public way. Now that will be ordered. Do we have a motion on this one?
I made
first, second.
Jesse.
Second.
Yep. Any discussion on Carey Street?
Yeah, I guess this would be a question for Ms. Mish. Can you just speak to why this was recommended and what would be, I mean, it says that the feeling is that these historic streets provide links with the city's network and core that create vehicular and pedestrian connectivity throughout the neighborhood. I mean, I'm familiar with Carey Street, and I'm struggling to see the vehicular or pedestrian connectivity.
So I should have looked at all of these. Oh, you have that up there. That's good. So you know, that was 2.5 years ago that the Planning Board made a recommendation on that. I think, again, this is probably one of the ones that after discussion, the next wave that came through, they were sort of teetering on, you know, at what point do they really, is this become really more of a political decision? I think this is an older street that's built out with lots. It's been used historically as with public access. If I'm not mistaken, and I don't know if this is the parcel, I need to look at the bigger, but I think there's a connection at the end of it, a walking path at the end of it. So I think the interest of saving that public access and connection to that was part of the conversation. But again, it's one of those really old streets in the core neighborhoods that that surround downtown that you know, they had sort of longer discussions about the benefits of having that as a public way.
Yeah. I can just add some information that there is a pedestrian path that connects to the series of condos, the City View condos. Although, if you ask some of the residents, some will like that connection and some won't, frankly, because they feel that sometimes people walk into their yard, but for better or worse, there is pedestrian connectivity at the end.
Any other questions on Cary? Then hearing none, all in favor of accepting and recommending in finance? Aye.
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 Great. Opposed? All right, that's our streets for tonight. So the next one is upon the recommendation of the mayor. The following expenditures from the Senior Service Gift Fund are to be approved. $24,500 for the purchase of 7 new pieces of commercial-grade fitness equipment for the Senior Center Fitness Center, and to have the current fitness equipment moved to a new location in the Senior Center. $400 for the purchase of a billiard table, pool balls, cue sticks, and a cue rack, and miscellaneous billiard supplies. This is in memory of Ralph Taylor. $1,000 for the purchase of volunteer bulletin whiteboard announcement displays in memory of Mary Smith. $3,500 for the purchase of a marketplace wagon kiosk to use in the lobby as a point of sale for mini sale merchandise in memory of Mary Netto. And $5,500 for the purchase of a sign for the front of the Senior Center. And we have the mayor here to speak to this one.
Also,
we have a motion in finance before we
make a motion.
Second.
I just would ask if you would recognize the Director of Senior Services, Patricia Shaughnessy, who's here.
So we'll
she can describe these initiatives that we're asking for council authorization to expend these funds for.
Thank you.
Good evening. Our gift fund, the revenues for that come from contributions that are made in memory of someone, also donations that are provided to us, and more recently we had a kick the tire campaign to raise funds for a new van. So basically that's the money that's within our gift fund. Our membership in the fitness center has dramatically increased. We have a plan to move our current fitness center from the front of the building to the back of the building. It's a bigger space, and adding additional equipment, which is for the purchase with the $24,500. So it would include the new equipment as well as moving the current equipment to the back room, which would be the new fitness center. The games room has a pool table, and it's time to have a lot of new supplies for that. It's well used, and Mr. Taylor was an avid pool player. The volunteer bulletin whiteboard announcement display would be at the main entrance when you come into our building, and it would reflect the new needs that we have for volunteers, and it would be news clippings and just keeping people up to date about volunteer opportunities at the Senior Center. The marketplace wagon kiosk is similar to what you see in the mall in the center where merchandise is sold. One of the things in our lobby is a mini sale table, which supplements our budget. So that would be in the lobby. It's something that we would be able to move rather than taking down tables and all the merchandise that's on it when we need the whole lobby for other programs. And then purchase a sign for out front of the Senior Center. You probably all have seen the Northampton Senior Center stainless steel lettering above the front doors. Most people don't see it there. And so many times people have asked me, our board members, other people, where's the Senior Center? So a sign out front would be providing more visibility for us. Excuse me. And it may display what kinds of programs that are upcoming instead of us putting our sandwich sign out.
Councilor Barch.
Yes. I think this is the right way to go with the sign in front of the Senior Center. You're absolutely correct, because I have many residents in Ward 6, which you know, who do use that, and I've heard it myself, where people have said that there should be a lit sign out in front, and I agree with that. Also, too, on the $24,500 on the purchase of 7 new pieces of equipment, which I had talked with you about that, Patty, in regards to, we had heard something to the effect that curves was thinking of donating their equipment, and can you explain that you did go down and look at it, and we could not accept it?
Right, Curves was located on Damon Road, and they were closing, and they provided us the opportunity to have their pieces of equipment, and one of our fitness assistants went down to Curves with me to look at the equipment, and we chose not to accept the equipment because of the concern that, because it's Curves equipment, meaning it's manufactured for Curves, and the problem of having it with maintenance. So if something happened to it, that was one of our main concerns. And we just didn't think it was gonna be appropriate for our fitness center. Very generous offer, but it wasn't something that we could accept, even though we love donations at the senior center.
Thank you.
I think it's appropriate for folks following at home that, just as Patty said, these are donations. This is not money that's coming out of the general fund or any other line item. These are donations that we are obliged to approve and authorize the disbursement. But these are gifts that you guys earned or were given in memory of many very important people to the senior center. So.
Yes.
Any other questions? All right, in finance, all in favor of positive?
Aye.
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 Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next one is upon the recommendation of the mayor. Order that in order to reduce interest costs, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to provide for sale and issuance of refunding bonds under Mass General Law, Section 44. Section 21A, to refund all or any portion of the remaining principal of and redemption premium and interest on any of the city's general obligation bonds outstanding as of the date of this vote. Do we have a motion on this? We'll have the mayor explain it to us. Second?
Probably the easiest way to describe this is if bond council speak uses the term refund, but really what's happening is we're basically refinancing the bonds. And so our bond council has done an analysis of several of our outstanding bonds, and they have made a determination that by doing this refund process that we would be able to potentially save, these are estimated savings, about $434,000 in interest costs by doing this. So that's why we're asking for this authorization to move forward with it.
Questions? Councilor Adams?
I mean, that all makes sense, but why not just have them come before the city council?
Come who?
Well, I mean, this allows to just, your office to do it without coming before the city council.
This is a, but it would only refer to the general obligation bonds that we currently have outstanding as of this date, as of the date of the vote. So
this is no new money. This is
we're basically dealing with. I mean, this is the order that literally the bond council wrote this order. This is the language that they had us use in order to make the sale of the bonds. So this wouldn't carry forward into the future. It's only bonds that are currently outstanding. So. It wouldn't be a blanket forevermore. We could just do this.
And and the money that was spent and financed with these bonds did come through this body initially.
Oh yes, of course, yeah. And we're obviously the debt service is part of the budget every year. So this will be $400,000 less in debt service that we can, which will help our overall debt program and free up space for future capital borrowings. We've done this in the past, when interest rates were favorable. So that's what this is about.
Any other questions on this one of the mayor? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation in finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Great, thank you. The next, upon the recommendation of the mayor, whereas the Northampton Police Department receives numerous gifts of tangible personal property each year, and whereas Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 5 53A and a half provides that the acceptance of gifts of tangible personal property will require a vote of the City Council and approval of the mayor. And whereas many of the gifts received by the Northampton Police Department are of relatively low market value, and whereas it's in the best interest of the police department in the city to streamline the process by which gifts up to a certain value may be accepted and placed into service of the police department in the community. Now, therefore, be ordered that the City Council hereby authorizes the Chief of Police to accept gifts of tangible personal property with a fair market value of $5,000 or less from the federal government, a charitable foundation, a private corporation, or similar statutory entity, individual, or from the Commonwealth or any political subdivision thereof. The Chief of Police shall use such gifts for restricted purposes provided by the donor, or if no restriction is attached to the gift, for such other purposes as the Chief deems advisable. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second?
Second.
Okay. As you may recall, we came forward last month with a similar order for the school department to make sure we were complying with Mass General Law regarding gift acceptance. This one was in part generated because we formerly contracted out our ACO services to a private contractor, and now that the ACO is a city employee, and so in part this was spurred because we often receive donations from folks who are donating animal supplies, food and toys and other things like that. And so, and sometimes even from organizations. And then similarly to that, we also sometimes receive gifts of things like toys for cruisers. Sometimes officers will have toys in their cars if they encounter a scene where there's a young child or someone involved. And so oftentimes people will donate toys for that effort. So again, like the school department one, where we have these routine sorts of charitable donations to help support police services, rather than have to come forward to the City Council to have dog bones and dog toys and biscuits and dog beds approved, that this allows the chief the discretion to accept these. Mm-hmm.
Councilor Dwight.
We've been making these adjustments a few times, and it does make sense in the context of when these rules were originally established. Of course, the previous threshold made sense. It was the value was, I think through inflation now is roughly equivalent. I would imagine it's not back on the day when a $2,000 charitable donation was a significant contribution. Clearly,
I think one of the issues that's happened is there's sometimes been some confusion about Mass General Law as it relates to gift acceptance, because like the city can accept cash donations, like the senior center can accept donations, don't have to get a vote to accept it, you don't have to get a vote, you know, it's when we want to expend it, like you just witnessed, we have to come forward and do it. When there's gifts of real property, technically any gift of real property has to be approved by the council and the mayor. So if someone wants to donate, you know, a bag of dolls to the police department or animal control supplies or whatever, by the letter of the law, we need to have council approval and the mayor's approval of those acceptance of those gifts. So, again, it hasn't been a major issue, although now this sort of was spurred by the ACO saying, what do I do if people want to give gifts? Is it okay to allow them to do that? Nancy had previously received them, but she was a private individual, so who was contracted with the city. So,
and the ACO is the animal control officer.
That's so correct.
I believe that the reason the spirit of this level of granular oversight was established was for concerns of, say, someone wanted to donate a taser or something, there were something that we might not necessarily agree with, that we could actually have the opportunity to say thanks but no thanks.
That's that's possibly true, yeah.
But to provide some type of oversight and constraint, I agree. I actually think this is reasonable. It's just mm-hmm. And I want the public to understand the adjustment and thresholds, yeah. That's all.
I think the other concern would be like if departments were accepting houses or property or large vehicles, right, or things like that that would carry with it a liability, you know, a financial liability. You might want to have, you definitely would want to have oversight of that.
And one quick follow-up, and I don't want to go down a rabbit hole with this, but seized assets in particularly with the police,
those fall under a different law.
It's a different category. Do you have no authority over that?
What's that?
We have no.
We don't have any authority over that.
Or
no.
Use?
No, we do not. That is actually under state law. That's, they do have the authority. Those are not gifts.
No, I suppose not.
So it's involuntary.
Yes. So, yeah, it's a.
And typically, you don't see the keys. They don't see the case of dog chewies, right? Those things, you got to go get those done.
Yes. So, yeah, so that's a different category.
Councilor Adams.
If the purpose is to facilitate the acceptance of gifts for, you know, the examples that were given, like food for the ACO or whatever, mm-hmm. I mean, 5,000 seems like a lot. And just to play devil's advocate, because I think it makes sense, the way it reads, if a private corporation or individual wanted to make monthly gifts of $4,900, they could do that.
It's only personal property. So they would have to, we're only talking, they could actually give $4,000 monetary, they could write a $5,000 check to the police chief every month and she could put it in a gift account. She just couldn't expend it without coming forward to the council. This only applies to real property. So anything that's not financial. It's a distinction, and it's caused confusion over time. Some people think I have to go to the council to get a vote to accept a donation. You don't, actually. You can accept the gifts, but you can't actually expend it of any amount without authorization. So this is just gifts of real property. So, and again, we didn't. This number isn't, you know, we just were trying to pick a number that was reasonable, and, you know, if someone. So that was where it came from.
Other questions?
I'm just thinking, if a gun company wanted to give, you know, $4,900 worth of Glocks every month, for example, I mean.
I suppose, I don't know what a Glock goes for. I don't actually know that we would, I'm not sure that we would accept them. There would probably be ethical reasons why we couldn't accept them, but I'm not sure. That's a good, I suppose that's a possibility.
That would. Which is about 5 blocks.
Yeah. Oh, that really? That's it.
Could we accept new office chairs?
Yes.
Councilor.
I'd like to make a.
You'd have to vote on.
Specter doesn't wind up on the floor. It's a little blue.
It's the one
chair. So.
Your back.
No. To this one, any other questions in finance? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Great. Okay. Upon the recommendation of the mayor, whereas the city council appropriated $100,000 for the acquisition of a new snow thrower for the DPW as part of the FY16 capital plan, and whereas the replacement cost of the vehicle has been determined to be $132,360, ordered that the following amounts have been identified as surplus funds and that these amounts can be reprogrammed to provide the $32,360 in additional funding for the acquisition of the snow thrower. $21,546.07 to be reprogrammed from the JFK School Lights Project. $8,163.93 to be reprogrammed from the FY13 Capital Plan DPW Dump Truck. And $2,650 to be reprogrammed from the FY14 Capital Plan DPW Equipment Account. Motion to finance?
Second.
Okay. So this was one of those giant snowblower on steroid snow thrower machines that was on the FY16 Capital Plan. As is often sometimes the case when we get estimates for these vehicles, we try to get a good estimate from. But often then there's the whole budget process. We have to wait till July 1st. We go out to bid, and basically the vehicle came in $32,000 more than had been anticipated. This is a very critical piece of equipment, and so we have identified these three other projects where we can move money from them. I just want to mention the JFK School Light project. That was a case where the project came in $21,000 under what we had estimated it to be. And that was for the installation of the safety light signal system at JFK. And then you see the other projects. The phone's ringing. I think it's the school calling to tell me something. So that's what this would be about. And I know Mr. Huntley is here if you have specific questions about
just the piece ran of out the door.
He just ran out the door.
Oh, that's okay. No problem.
He saw you teeing him up and he ran away.
Oh, I believe, yes, we're having some issues downtown. There's been some suspicious packages identified, and so the police are doing some closing off of some streets for safety purposes. So police and now DPW have been called to assist with some of the street closures. But if you've been downtown or been in any of the side streets when they're doing the actual cutting back of the snowbanks, it's the giant snowblower, yellow, that where dump trucks ride along beside it and it throws snow into the dump trucks. It's a critical piece of equipment, and so we need to upgrade that one.
Any questions on the giant snowblower? All right. All in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Again, on a recommendation of the mayor, that $10,000 be appropriated from the stabilization fund to fund design services relative to the replacement of the city's obsolete and unsupported voice over internet protocol telephone system. I believe it's a telephone system.
Yeah, so as you, some of you may know, I was actually on the council, and when we did this program, I think it was back in 2007.
Seven.
We purchased a voice over internet protocol system. We actually used our Comcast funds from our Comcast contract to do that. It is a system that is now, the company has been sold and sold again. It is now a system that is no longer supported. There's no longer, you can't buy equipment for it. The manufacturer no longer supports it. When we do have to find spare parts, we have to go on eBay to try to find them. Our IT director has identified this as a high priority IT project. We already have the cost of the actual system projected in the capital plan, I'm going to ask if you would, could you take over the, I just have a call coming in.
So, do you have any questions?
Any other questions on that?
This is just to do the study so that when we do incorporate the actual purchase into the capital plan, we have better information and a more solid number.
Any other questions on this one? Councilor Dwight.
As the mayor noted and Councilor Murphy noted, that the time we established this, it came with a substantial amount of controversy and discussion about the value of a system like this. The system upgrade that we're looking at, is it more robust? Is it something that, this is substantially different price line that we're talking about on this, in this instance. Can you speak to that differential?
Well, Antonio Pagan came to the Capital Planning Committee last night, and he did talk about it, and he did say that when we put this system in, we were a little bit at the forefront of the voice over internet protocol, and that it was one of the newer systems, and it was just so new, it didn't have all of the issues worked out. And so the new system that we'll get, he assured us, is going to be one that's going to have a lot more longevity. And he did talk a lot about coming up with a system that relied less on certain kinds of hardware and was more software driven, so that when we needed to upgrade, we wouldn't be looking at so much hardware replacement.
So this is not the final bill that we'll be looking at for the system by any means.
This is actually to hire the professional that we need to design the system that we need to go out to bid for, because these are such highly specialized systems. So we have to hire basically a telecom company to design the system that we can then go out to bid. So part of what we're trying to do is get the money, get the design going, because we know well, this is a high priority in the capital program, so when July 1st rolls around, we'll have a biddable design that we can go out to bid. And I can tell you that we have some phones now that are starting to act glitchy. We have delays, you know, long delay, sometimes the ring and the long delay. And the IT director has told me that, you know, if the brains of this thing goes down, we're without a phone system, basically.
No, so, and other problems too. I mean, VoIP systems are, that's what I was hoping that a robust study.
Yes.
Of a comprehensive integration system that makes sense. Your Honor, do you need to be excused? Because
yeah, it's dispatch. So I'm gonna
Okay. Need to talk with dispatch. You go do what you got to do.
So, and again, we had a big discussion at Capital Improvements Committee last night, and with these things, the problem is usually the human interface things, the telephone sets. I mean, they have physical activity. People dump coffees in them. And if you can't replace the handsets or service the handsets anymore, you know, it doesn't matter how good the switch is. If you can't get parts to sit on people's desks, then the thing doesn't work anymore. These are throughout the city and the schools. They're in the schools as well. In fact, half the city phones are in the schools, aren't they?
According to Antonio last night, we have 750 phones throughout the city. So.
I'm sorry, doesn't this also include communication systems for central services to program, I don't know if it's independent of the systems that control all of the buildings? And
Those are over the internet, not necessarily the phone lines.
Yeah, they go
web-based.
This goes over the fiber that we do that on,
right.
But it's not part of the phone system, I don't think. It communicates over the same network,
right.
But it's not part of the phones.
It's not part of the phone system.
Councillor Adams, did you have a question?
No.
Councillor LaBarge, did you have a question? No. Any other questions on the phones? Then all in favor of positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Good. All right. One that I inadvertently skipped. Upon the recommendation of the mayor, ordered that $7,500 of the remaining balance of the FY14 capital plan project for Leeds skylight window replacement be reprogrammed to fund a necessary upgrade of the security system hardware at the Leeds school. We have a motion on this one?
Second.
Any?
Fairly straightforward. Need to do this hardware upgrade to the existing system, and there is this remaining balance in an older capital project that we want to reallocate. So That's the purpose. It's, you know, school capital money that's being transferred to another school capital project. Same building.
Okay. Yeah. Since there are no other questions on this one, all in favor of a positive recommendation? Aye. 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 Opposed? And the last one, upon the recommendation of the mayor, whereas Mass General Law 40, Section 4A allows for joint operation of public activities among government units, and whereas Mass General Law 40, 4A requires that such intergovernmental agreements be approved in a city by the city council and mayor, and whereas the city of Northampton provides services and shares these services with other municipalities, now order that pursuant to Mass General Law 40, Section 4A, the city council hereby authorizes the city of Northampton to enter into intermunicipal agreement with the town of Hadley to provide sealer of weights and measures services. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second.
So, as you may know, we currently provide sealer and weights of measure services to obviously Northampton, but also to the towns of Granby and Amherst. So you not only see John Fry's signature in Northampton, but you see it in those other towns on pumps and weights and scales. We've now negotiated with the town of Hadley to add the town of Hadley as part of our service area. And actually, we had previously had the town of Southampton who opted out of the program, which caused a little bit of a reduction in the program. And so Hadley is now coming on board. So this basically allows us to enter into amend the intermunicipal agreement to add Hadley to it.
Hadley has a lot more gas stations than
they
South.
They certainly do, so. And scales and
other things. Yeah.
So they do have a lot of them. So, and
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes. Susan, I also want to thank Susan for a call today in regards to wanting to know what would be possibly the dollar figure, Mayor, that we would be getting for doing this service.
It's about $18,000 a year. We would, and again, that helps to pay for John's time and staff time and support him, and it's revenue to the city as well. Yeah.
Thank you.
Other questions on this financial alert? Hearing none, then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And that is our agenda for this evening for finance. So there's no other business, a motion to adjourn.
Councilors, Mr. President, if I could, I hate to interrupt regular business. I just didn't want the councilors to be concerned. I just want to update you on what's happening on Main Street.
Would you please?
So there were four suspicious packages that were identified on Main Street. And so the Main Street has been shut down. We do have the state police bomb squad. They are in the process of x-raying one of them right now, and we'll probably open it up and figure out what it may be. There's some conflicting reports about whether it was whether it in fact is some sort of a threat or potentially some school project that gone amiss. So anyway, I just wanted to update you if you're hearing helicopters, and obviously the DPW director had to leave, but that was dispatched and the assistant chief calling me just to give me an update. So so that's why you're seeing sirens and hearing sirens nearby, but luckily not hearing anything else. So hopefully they'll have it resolved very quickly, and I'll keep you updated as the meeting goes along.
Thank you very much. We're trapped in here anyway.
Exactly.
Maybe dog biscuits for the police.
Yes.
And we move out of recess.
I think rules you out as suspects.
Yes. You
know, oh, thanks.
There's always that.
So we're adjourned.
Anyway. I know. So we move out of recess and back into the regular meeting. And for folks who are trapped here now and who are watching along at home, this is going to seem really strange, but we're going to go and vote on those very things you just heard discussed in Finance Committee meeting. Believe it or not, this is actually an expeditious way to process these things in any event. So please bear with us. I'm not going to read all the orders. I will merely give the main titles, and then it's still open to debate. If you see the absence of debate or questions, you'll recognize that we just had those questions and discussions. As I said, keeping score. So first up is the easement on the land of Northampton Wireworks Office of Business and Technology, LLC. This is the first reading. I'll accept the motion.
So, second.
Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Will be reviewed again for a second reading at our next council meeting in November. Next up is the order to accept Warner Row as a public way.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded for first reading. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. Next up, we also have the order to accept Bright Avenue as a public way in this first reading.
Move to approve.
Motion's made. Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? I'd just like to add and reinforce kind of the point that Councilor Sharrow is moving towards there. And this is some of the dust-ups we've been having about some of these road acceptances, and it should be known if we accept this as a city street, it comes under city rules and not the rules of the individuals who abut the property, and that makes it a public way and thereby subject to the possibility of all the rules that govern public ways, which means you can't put up your own sign telling people they can't park next to your house. So no further discussion, so roll call on this, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
We have an order to, and that passes in first reading. Order to accept Maple Avenue as a public way.
Move to approve it.
Second.
Okay. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yep.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. We have the order to accept Carey Street as a public way.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. We have a financial order to approve expenditures from the Senior Services Gift Fund. This is first reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion on these items? Roll call, please.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
That also passes in first reading. Now we have a financial order to authorize treasurer, the treasurer, to provide for the sale and issuance of refunding bonds.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Now we have the financial order to authorize the police chief to accept gifts of $5,000 or less in first reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Passes in first reading. We have a financial order, the $7,500 to be reprogrammed to fund necessary upgrade of the security system hardware at the Leeds Elementary School.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Now we have the financial order to appropriate $10,000 from the stabilization fund to fund services for replacement of the voice over IP system. And I'll first reading, I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. Next up, we have financial orders for intermunicipal agreements with Hadley, Sealer of Weights and Measures, the opportunity to see John Fry's name throughout the land.
Move to approve.
Motion's made. Second. Second. Any discussion? Councilor John.
Mr. Fry has a really excellent signature. Just nice. It's just a nice, solid signature.
He signs each one individually. There's no stamp. Should be noted. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. We have a financial order to appropriate $100,000 for the acquisition of a super duper new snow thrower for the DPW. This is there's a request for two readings on this one as well.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes. Suspend.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Suspend Rule 14.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded for suspension of rules to allow for a second reading. Is there, can someone speak to this issue as to why the two readings are necessary?
To get it procured and outfitted for before the winter season comes. And
soon.
I don't want to jinx us that we're going to have a snowstorm, but we between the now and the next meeting. But we would like to acquire this piece of property and get it integrated into our inventory as soon as possible. Yeah.
Much
and again, it was a project that was approved on the capital plan. It just the cost has changed. So, yeah.
Any other discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept a motion for second reading.
So moved.
Second.
All right. Any further discussion? Roll call on the second reading, please.
Councilor Shira.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
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 That passes in second reading and is thereby approved. We have a financial order regarding the City of Northampton's tax classification. This is the second reading.
So moved. Second.
For folks watching home, the Northampton has what's known as a factor of one tax rate, which was approved in the first reading and has been. And that means essentially commercial property and personal and private property homeowners pay the same rate, which should be noted is unique in this valley. Other communities, surrounding communities, have a split rate where commercial properties pay more. But Northampton, I won't expound on that more, but that's the difference here, and that's what we're going to be voting on. Any discussion on this point? Roll call, please.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shira.
Yes.
That passes in second reading and has been approved. We have a financial order pertaining to the CPA allocation and debt service. This is second reading from the last council meeting.
Move to approve.
Any discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shira.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Now we have financial order. This is second reading. Financial order for pertaining to the intermunicipal agreements.
Move to approve.
Got it here. This is for to the town of Chester to add the town of Chester to the existing contract. Towns of Amherst, Chesterfield, Cummington, Hadley, Middlefield, Pelham, Williamsburg, Goshen, and Worthington, and members of the Central Hampshire Veterans Services District to provide veteran services. The Veteran Services Officers Services. Did I say service enough in there?
Yes, we did.
Okay, so that's this will be second reading on this item.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shira.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
That's been approved in second reading. Financial order, this is also in second reading. This is a financial order of $3,000 appropriated from the CPA funding to the Fitzgerald Lake Invasive Plant Eradication Projects.
Move to approve.
Second.
Seconded. Further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shira.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Yes.
This is somewhat relative to what we were already discussing before, but this is the second reading for the financial order allowing schools to accept gifts of low market value in accordance with Mass General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53A.5, which was cited by Councilor Murphy earlier, as you probably all recall, But with the maximum cap of $10,000, the second reading, I'll accept the motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any further discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrick.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Ashby.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yeah. Now we're up to road acceptances on second reading. You kind of wonder why anyone wanted to run for council. We're not showing off the real fun we have, but this is getting stuff out of the way. This is order to accept Ridgeview Road as a public way, and this is accepted motion.
Second.
And seconded. Further discussion on this item? Councilor Adams.
I went back after last discussion because I was afraid I had the wrong street, which I didn't. But after hearing what the other councilors had to say and taking into consideration, particularly sidewalks and the fact that, as Councilor Dwight pointed out, there's development going on up there. When that happens, there's just a greater likelihood that there'll be more people and more usage of the sidewalks, it'll be more public way-like at that point. But after thinking about it, I think it's enough as is.
Any further discussion on this item? Subject to the public comment, is that, you know, the thing that makes me distinctly uncomfortable, and I've said it before and I'm going to repeat it, that we start establishing thresholds of class as for qualification for roads, road acceptance, is a very slippery slope. And we base these on whether it meets actual criteria that irrespective of the value of the homes on those properties or abutting properties. And I think that should hold. I think that, while I appreciate in some level the sentiment, I think there was some hyperbole when we're actually $600,000 homes are basically twice what an average home costs in Northampton. An average house in Wellesley costs $780,000. And I think it's just it makes me feel really uncomfortable speaking, because the converse comes up when once upon a time people just speak of poor people and subsidized housing, how they would not qualify. And I really don't, those are horrible doors to open. So, and especially in the context of the road discussion. So that was my objection.
Councilor, I really respect hearing that from you, because 2 weeks ago, it bothered me when I heard that also. And like I had stated, that I do have homeowners there who did live at Brookside Circle. They saved, and they work hard, and they have a home there.
Councilor,
my objection to begin with was not because that. Based along cost.
Yeah, I
just to reiterate that. Yeah.
No, I recognize that you had made that distinction.
Exactly.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrick.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
That passes in second reading and makes Ridgeview Road a public way. Next up, we have an order to accept Pine Valley Road and Pine Valley Extension as public ways. This is also in second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Councilor O'Donnell.
Like Councilor Adams on the previous order, I voted no on this one last time, but I was persuaded by comments from Councilor Klein in particular. And now that I have some clarity on what the planning board recommended, I'm just going to vote yes on it. So just an explanation.
Any other discussion on this? Councilor.
New title, Pam.
Pam? Oh, we need a motion to amend this, and Pam will present you with the amendment. It's Scribner-related, right?
No, you're changing the planning board decision based on...
Oh, right, thank you, yes, yes. This is the planning board recommendation clarification memo from Carolyn Mish, which is attached, or you will find in your packet. Let's see. Carolyn, I'm going to spare you being called up if you want to, but...
May I make the motion?
Yeah, sure.
Just on the fly to amend the fourth whereas to read, whereas the Public Works Commission has recommended laying out and accepting Bottoms Road as a public way, and the planning board having no objection or making a neutral recommendation.
Second.
The amendment is made and second. Is there any discussion on the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? All right, now as amended, I'll accept a motion again.
Move to approve.
In order to accept Pine Valley Road, Pine Valley Extension as public way. Motion made and second as amended. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Counselor Shara.
Yes.
Counselor Spector.
Yes.
Counselor Adams.
Yes.
Counselor Carney.
Yes.
Counselor Dwight.
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge.
Yes.
Counselor Murphy.
Yes.
That passes as amended in second. We have an, this is an order to accept Bottoms Road as a public way in second reading. The same with the clarification from the planning board, a motion to amend will be required, a similar motion. Accept them. Motion to put it on the floor first and then a second. Is there a motion?
Make a motion to put it on the floor.
Second.
Counselor O'Donnell, you interested in amending?
I've enthusiastically offered a similar amendment to change the fourth whereas to read, whereas the Public Works Commission has recommended laying out and accepting Bottoms Road as a public way, and the Planning Board having no objection.
Second.
Second to that amendment. This is to the amendment. All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Aye. Any abstentions? Okay. So I know I'm doing this kind of backwards here, but I'll now accept a new motion for to put as amended the order to accept Bottoms Road as a public way.
So moved.
As amended. Second. Sorry, second. Counselor Adams.
I did another visit to the street today, and it just seems like a private driveway to me. So I'm voting against this again.
Counselor Adams.
Yeah, I second that. It is a long driveway, so. Yep, I'm going to vote no as well.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Shara.
No.
Counselor Spector.
No.
Counselor Adams.
No.
Counselor Carney.
Yes.
Counselor Dwight.
No.
Counselor LeBarge.
No.
Counselor Murphy.
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell.
No.
Well, that fails. That fails in second reading. With two yeses. Now we have an order to expand the salt.
Counselor, I just wanted to give.
Oh, yeah, would you please? Yeah.
The developing story. So the first box has been x-rayed and cleared, and they're proceeding on the other three. It appears that the first box may have been some sort of a camera or film attempt to create some sort of a box camera. You may know
right.
What this is.
Yeah, box camera, yes.
So there was film found inside of it. So the other packages are being x-rayed.
Are they similar packages?
Yes, they are. Okay. And so I believe...
Are there pinhole cameras, then it sounds like?
That have film in them, and they're, I assume, allowed to naturally be exposed to.
They need to be exposed by natural light through a pinhole, and it, yep. Well,
yes, but
my guess is they're exposed now.
Well, they're, They've been x-rayed, so.
They've been x-rayed.
Yeah.
Be a different, interesting art project.
So anyway, I'm hopeful that the other three packages are associated, well, I'm not happy that they would be associated with this, but I'm hopeful that they will be in the same situation. So I just wanted to update you that it appears that there's no safety issue or concern.
Thank you very much. And for those of you thinking about doing public art projects, you might want to give people a heads up before you go leaving random boxes all over the city and just leaving them there. But thank you, Your Honor, for that update. We're at a second reading. This is U, item U, order to expand the Sawmill Hill Conservation Area. The second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Kern.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
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 That passes in second reading. Now, also in second reading, this is the item you heard referred to by Paige Brody in public comment. This is the financial order to surplus the Fiker School to allow for lease of the building, and this will be the second reading. I'll accept a motion to put it on the floor.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Councilor Adams.
Hey, I voted no last time, but I vote yes this time. I mean, at the request of the supporters, at the request of those who would be leasing the building, now requested a yes vote.
Yes. I guess I'd like an opportunity as well to kind of correct the record a little bit about the statements that were made in the public comment session, which I was, I just want to correct the record because I did have a meeting. Well, first of all, just to set the stage, the school committee voted unanimously to adopt a lease and to send it to the city council for approval. The city council then took a first reading and approved that lease. And so the school committee's position has been that we need to wait to find out what the final disposition by the city council is to determine, you know, what the next steps would be. So individual members of the city, of the school committee, are not empowered to negotiate on behalf of the full school committee. The chair and the superintendent met with the president of the board and Ms. Brody, and we just discussed that's sort of where we were. We did try to answer some questions, and I actually emailed the president responses to some questions, factual questions she had about the lease as it was currently construed. One of the concerns was about the term good working order that's part of the lease agreement. And we tried to clarify that what good working order means is that you have to maintain the system, whatever it is, so that it functions, you know, carries out the function that it's supposed to provide. And so for example, if a roof system begins to leak, you do not have to replace the entire roof system. You can actually, you know, do a repair as long as the repair effectuates it so that it's in good working order. So we did try to provide some clarification. That was one of the questions that was asked because there was a concern that good working order was not a clear enough term. And so we did try to provide some clarification on what that means. But, you know, the school, I am not empowered to negotiate on behalf of the school committee because the school committee voted unanimously to have me bring this order forward to you. So until such time that the order is, you know, disposed of or voted in favor of, whatever it is, then the school committee would take action. And in this case, if you approve the lease, we'll issue the RFP, and I'm hopeful that they will bid on it. But so anyway, I just wanted to correct the record. I don't believe that I felt the characterization in public comment was not a fair one.
Just so that she can speak without the three-minute limitation, I'd like to recognize Ms. Brody.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Any opposed?
I can start with a specific question. Just to clarify, I think in your public comment, your request was pass it as in its current form, right?
To approve it. Yeah, we've evaluated both scenarios through to their ends, and even though the RFP and lease is a really difficult choice for us, again, we'd be going against legal counsel to sign it. We feel like, unfortunately, that's the only way to keep the process moving, you know, and as the mayor indicated, to let the RFP run its course because that's what the school committee approved. That's what we have to do to even be able to get to a point where we can negotiate some of those finer terms in the lease.
Any other questions to Ms. Brody or the mayor or whomever? Your Honor, you have to.
I guess I just need to correct. You're approving the lease
correct.
As it's written there. So we can't, right. If we want to renegotiate the lease, we need to bring it back to the city
right.
council.
Right. No, I suspect Paige knows that. And as we established before in the last discussion, that we can vote it up, we can vote it down. We can't amend or modify the contract. But as you also, I think, deftly said, nodding our head yes and, or saying yes and nodding our head no. I think that was somehow, and I think that more or less describes some of the debate and the discussion as people explain the reasons for their votes. But everyone seemed to be uniformly in favor of having this work out. So that, and I think to that degree, what you're asking, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that we allow the process to move forward for you to at least find some stability and resolution at the school committee level and have us release it and give you guys still that option.
I think that's our best hope at this point.
Are there any other questions or discussion on this point?
No.
Thank you, Paige. Roll call, please. This is second reading.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Kern.
Yes.
Councilor
Dwight. Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sarah.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now we have a financial order to fund the new headquarters for Parks and Recreation Department. This is second reading. If you recall, this is the financial order for $400,000 to create modular structures at the JFK School for the Parks and Recreation Department.
There's actually not a space specified. I just want to clarify that.
Right. Good point. I'm sorry. You do only mention that as a possibility, as a prospect. Yes. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I move approval.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion on this item? Roll call.
Councilor Kern.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor
O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor
Sarah.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. We're now up to orders and ordinances. The first one, which we already did, which was to approve the naming of the Northampton Wastewater Treatment Plant. Next up is item B, which is ordinance pertaining to the rural residential zoning. It comes with a positive recommendation on the committee on what?
Rules, ordinances.
Oh, okay. That's you guys from ordinance. Okay.
Appointments.
I've never seen it referred to in the deed report. That's a new acronym.
I know.
It's all right. Enjoy it. We're going to change the name soon. The
committee on ROW.
Ryan O'Donnell.
Yeah, that's right. This is rules, orders. Okay. Thank you. First reading. This comes, as I said, with a positive recommendation from the committee on ROW. If you'll allow me, I'm going to read this here. In the year 2015, upon the recommendation of Office Planning and Sustainability, an ordinance of the City of Northampton providing that the Code of Ordinances for the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, be amended by revising Section 350, 350B, 350C of said code, updating the layout for the railroad district and eliminating nursing care assisted living, junk cars, community centers, modifying setbacks for ground mounted PV, among other changes. And the ordinance will read that Section 350-B of the Code of Ordinances be amended as follows. Delete RR column in its entirety, and that 350C of the Code of Ordinances be amended as follows. Delete a section on the dimensions for RR district from this table, and add new table of use and dimension regs or dim regs RR as following. And you'll see here, does everyone want me to elaborate on this?
Well, Carol,
does somebody want to speak to this, actually?
Can we recognize Carol?
Actually, well, first, I'd like a motion to put this on the floor.
I'll make a motion to put it on the floor.
And a second?
Second.
Okay. And then, Carolyn, would you like to speak to this? So I can spare everyone having me read the... And it's rural residential, I'm sorry, and I said railroad, of course. I'm just going back to my HO model scale days, so it's, yes.
I'm not sure there are any railroads up there. But.
No, you know.
So these two ordinances are coming together as packet. I'll go through rural residential first, but the idea for both of these is to, as you may recall, we've gone through and amended many of the districts to reformat them with hopefully a more user-friendly appearance and ability for anyone really to sort of pick up the document and say, okay, here's 90% of what I need to know in this district in terms of what's allowed for use, what the lot dimensions are. So that was primarily the impetus for the change to the rural residential. So it's going to match what we've done for urban residential A, B, and C, and some of the other districts as well. Through this modification, we took the opportunity to make changes to some of the items that maybe didn't make so much sense anymore, because this district hasn't been touched probably since the 70s. We've done some tweaking here and there for some of these districts, but we went through and looked at every single use to see if it still made sense. So that's why there's a list of uses that are proposed to be deleted from the rural residential as potentially allowed through special permit. And those are the elimination of the allowance by special permit for assisted living units or nursing homes. The idea is that the rural residential area isn't really an appropriate place to locate these types of uses. There's been a shift certainly in the industry, and there's been and also the intensity of the uses makes more sense in more of a core urban areas. In the rural residential district, we also have what's referred to as a rural incentive overlay, and it's just for a portion of it on the north side of Bridge Road. So we've eliminated that overlay as an option, primarily because it was only used once in the 30 years, I think, that it was in place, and it no longer makes sense given the other changes we've made to the zoning district. It was an incentive for the development of more dense cluster development with affordable housing. And we've evaluated that on a citywide level and believe that that's no longer necessary to have that incentive in that location. Also, the removal of the allowance for junk cars by special permit, community centers, and I guess those are the other two major categories that we're recommending be eliminated from the possibility for allowed uses in this district because it is an agricultural and rural residential area. And then we've made some proposed modifications to the setbacks for ground-mounted solar arrays to match what's allowed for detached accessory structures. So the same as they would be allowed as the same as garages or sheds or other structures, which is in this district 10 feet from the rear lot line and 10 feet from the side lot line. Currently, the PV arrays require 50 feet of setback And so that's pretty substantial and has limited the ability for some people to install those systems on their property. So we've had some requests for that modification. There are two other modifications that are actually one other modification and then just a little tiny text change that from the version that you have that I wanted to highlight. One is that this is sort of the first foray into modifications to detached accessory apartments. There's a proposal to allow them by site administrative site plans. So it would be a staff level review for the detached accessory dwelling units. Currently, it's by special permit from the zoning board. And the idea is that this, we've had a lot of these approved by the zoning board. Typically in the rural residential district, the units, the lots are larger, detached accessory structures have very specific regulations about where they can be located on the property and how they're oriented, the size, and the fact that there's ownership required in one of the units. So they've been fairly non-controversial. And so much of the review by the zoning board up to this point has been pretty simple process. So this is sort of a trial for doing it as a staff level review. It still would allow appeals by abutters if there's an issue, and then it would be appealed to the zoning board. And then the minor text change is just to clarify that there's a section in the ordinance that requires a larger lot size, 80,000 square feet, if you're on both private water and private sewer. So just adding the word private in front of sewer is the only modification that would need to be done on the floor here, unless, of course, you all have other changes.
Could you explain that again on private?
Oh, sure. So there's a different, there are two, but I just want to reiterate that everything else in the district stays the same. The minimum lot size requirements, all the uses stay the same. Currently, there are two different types of lot sizes required for residential uses, and it depends on whether or not you're on city water or private, city water and sewer or private water and sewer. And so it's really, you need a larger lot size, 80,000 square feet, if you have both a well and a septic system. And so it's just a clarification that both of those things are necessary to trigger the larger lot.
Gotcha. I think that's what it reads on the version that I have, anyway.
Oh, okay.
It says 40,000 square feet minimum, parentheses, 80,000 square feet if private water and sewer. Is that what you want?
No, we want private water and private sewer. Just add one more private.
Why community centers being eliminated and community centers made? And what is a community center, a congregate point for community members? I mean,
Because of the nature of the district and the fact that there are very limited number of areas in that district. So we're talking about mostly the western and far north part of the city, northwest corners of the city. And community centers are public gathering places. So currently, when looking at the map, there really aren't any existing facilities, and it seemed to make more sense to look at areas that are closer in town to where there's more densely populated neighborhoods and opportunities to create those if those ever came about. There's still a special permit in some of the other districts, and it just seemed that there wouldn't be an opportunity to do that, and it probably makes more sense in an area that's more walkable and accessible.
But does it make sense prophylactically to eliminate the prospect if folks who lived in that area wanted, because it's more remote from those central businesses, services, that they might want someplace. I mean, it just doesn't seem like it's much of a threat. And in that it's not much of a threat, I don't understand why we would preemptively eliminate the prospect of it.
I agree. It's not really a threat. We are just looking at trying to one of the goals would be to encourage uses that make sense in certain districts.
Right.
And so so community centers are places where we typically want to see people who can access it via walking or biking.
Right.
So no, it's not a threat, but it's just good, better practice, I guess.
Right, because usually when we include these things, it's to encourage certain behaviors as opposed to discouraging certain behaviors, I suppose. I mean, we don't specify you can't build a reactor there or put pinhole cameras there or anything like that. So it's interesting that we singled that out. The other thing I had a question about was the PV array setbacks. Does this open, and I don't know where we stand with this, but I know that throughout the country, neighbor conflicts about trees that might block the light of somebody's PV array. And if you come closer to the setback, does that subject the abutting property owner to be obliged in some way to not prevent, if they built up and they started to block the sunlight? I know in California there are a number of suits associated with that.
We don't have any solar access ordinances or regulations, so no, it's really, individual site based on their property boundaries and maybe what's happening on the surrounding property. So no, we haven't gotten to that point. We've had the conversation actually closer in town. There was a discussion about, by minimizing the setbacks, are we then preventing the potential for people to install PV systems? It's a balance of beneficial interests, I think, on both sides. Trees provide a great benefit. So do alternative energy systems.
But if you had a garage that had that smaller setback, you could put solar panels on it.
Yes.
So it's just like the same thing, but there's no garage.
That's that was sort of the reason for allowing the setbacks to be the same, because we do allow PV arrays on top of garages. So and the workaround up to this point has been to create a structure.
Build a garage.
And then put the array on top. Right.
Any other questions? No further discussion? Your Honor?
I just wanted to interrupt with another update.
Oh, okay.
Opening shortly, and thankfully there were no one was hurt, and there were nothing more. They did not contain any explosives.
Excellent. Thank you. That's great. Thank you. Councilor O'Donnell.
I would just like to make sure we include the amendment that Ms. Mish suggests.
For private sewer?
Yeah. I don't know. Would you like to have a formal motion on that?
Would you please? Yep.
I move that where it says 80,000 square feet, if private water and sewer, it says private water and private sewer.
Second. Motion is made and seconded for an amendment. Is there any discussion on the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Now we move to the order as amended. Any further discussion? Roll call, please. I did it properly this time. Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. And a note to citizens who might have concerns relative to these regulations, you have 2 weeks actually to share the information with us. So, or if you have objections, please notify your counselor or let the planning office know, and be subject to discussion at the second reading. And this pertains to this one as well. This is an ordinance pertaining to rural residential zoning. This is a positive recommendation from the Committee on Rural.
This is suburban residential.
This is, yes, thank you. Hang on a second. I hopped over. There it is. This is suburban residential. I'm sorry, not. I'll spare you the boilerplate, but essentially this is modifying section 350B of the Code of Ordinances to be amended as follows. Delete SR column in its entirety, and that 350C of the Code of Ordinances be amended as follows. Delete a section on the dimensions for RR district from this table and add new the table of use and dimension regs SR as the following. And then we'll have Carolyn walk us through this one, please.
So, again, very similar to rural residential, we are changing, updating the tables, and made similar changes to the uses, eliminating junk cars and nursing homes and assisted living by special permit, no longer allowing those by special permit. Making a modification to the detached accessory apartments to be approved by site plan, administrative site plan. And again, setbacks for ground-mounted photovoltaic arrays to be the same as detached accessory structures. And also administrative site plan review for those. In this case, community centers were allowed by special permit. We're suggesting that makes sense in this district. It's a little bit closer in. There are schools that are close and within these zoning districts that could potentially then also double as community centers. And that's about it. Same modification for the private and water, private sewer lot size. Requirements.
Questions on this? No? Actually, I don't recall. I don't think I got the motion on the floor on this one. I'll accept the motion.
Second. This has to be amended too. Needs another private.
So you want to advance that amendment?
Sure. I would love. I like to move we amend it to add the word private to sewer so that it says private water and private sewer.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded for an amendment. Any discussion on the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Now we're back to the main order as amended. Councilor Adams.
Has the fire department been consulted?
Not in particular on these. No.
Don't follow.
All right. Then roll call, please.
Councilor Bard?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Obama?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrod?
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Again, same applies. Anyone, and in fact, they can see these proposed amendments, Carolyn, on the website at the planning website. So citizens interested in seeing what we've actually been projecting here and that we have in our packet, if you're interested in seeing it and you have some concerns, please let us know in the intervening 2 weeks. Now, next up, the ordinance pertaining to bike lanes on North Elm Street. This is a second reading on this one. It's
move approval.
Second.
Motion made and second. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrod?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. We have an ordinance pertaining to the prohibited parking on South Street. It was a positive recommendation from the Committee on Row, and as amended. So, is
move approval?
Second.
Motion's made. Second. Any discussion on this? Roll call, Pam, please.
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Yes.
Counselor
Adams?
Yes.
Counselor
Carney?
Yes.
Counselor
Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Yes. We're getting there, folks. We're down to the bottom. So we have reconsideration of the ordinance regarding parking spaces at the senior center. And this came with a positive recommendation from Transportation and Parking Commission, positive recommendation from the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments and Ordinances, passed in first reading on September 17th, 2015, with a roll call vote of 9 yes and 0 no. Passed in second reading October 1st, 2015, roll call vote of 7 yes, 0 no, 2 absent. And then a disapproval by the mayor on October 9th, 2015. And actually, first, I'll accept the motion to put this on the floor.
Make a motion to place it on the floor.
Second.
Second. And Councilor Donnelly, do you want to talk about your questions relative to this and stuff too?
Sure. I think that I think that there are two questions here. The first is about the particular ordinance about handicapped parking spaces behind the senior center. And I mean, I wrote the ordinance, but it was done at the request of the director of senior services, an employee of the executive branch. I mean, actually, before I kind of get into that, we should probably summarize the mayor's objections. And of course, the mayor is here and could do that if he wishes. But I mean, the long and short of it, the key sentence in his letter of disapproval was, I do not believe that the parking lot of an executive branch agency, like a senior center, library, school, is subject to city ordinance the way a traditional public off-street parking lot or garage is. And I kind of paraphrase that. But that's the essential question, is do we have the authority to pass rules or to pass legislation that would affect certain city property? And so to go back to what I was starting to say, the ordinance at hand is one thing, but I think there's that larger question out there that I really would like to debate. And of course, we do have the Ordinance Review Committee pending, which is a good forum to debate that. I think it would be healthy to debate it tonight a little bit too. But whether or not we implement these parking spaces administratively or legislatively is one thing. But the larger question is, what is the City Council's powers to legislate about city property generally?
And Councilor Adams, you expressed objections the last time when this came up too. Councilor O'Donnell sent a letter to the solicitor requesting his perspective on this as well too. We don't have a response yet, so Councilor Spector.
I'd like to hear Councilor. I was not here the last time. So if Councilor Adams, sure. So you objected for the same reasons that we did not have the power as a council to do that?
No. Councilor O'Donnell, that we do have the power to do this. We have the authority to regulate all public lots. The charter doesn't make any distinction between administrative lots and lots subject to the legislative control. And we have control over all public property. It's not under the jurisdictions of the school, and there's no exception under the new charter for this. And I just believe that it's extremely clear that we have the power to regulate this lot in this manner. I was surprised that there's this belief that we don't. I mean, it's very clear that we do. The solicitor didn't write an opinion stating that we were overstepping our jurisdiction. I think this is just purely an opinion of the mayor, but I think we certainly have the authority to regulate this in the manner that we did.
The only follow-up I would have is, since you're the only lawyer on the council, that I would say a discussion or debate on this, because it's kind of, it seems to me a legal argument. I would like to have the solicitor here, too, to answer questions in order. Mm-hmm. I don't feel even competent to ask appropriate questions, so I would like to have the debate when he is here, and therefore I would make a motion to table. And I'm not sure, let me take that back. The question would be when we table it, till, and could he come to the next meeting? And so before I make that motion, which is non-debatable, if we could discuss
right.
it.
Point of order, I mean, a motion to table is different from a motion to postpone, which is debatable.
Right.
So I'm not sure which motion I would make. I'd like to hear how we would, kind of the details of how we would go about.
My recommendation would be a motion to postpone. To do precisely what you asked, to have the solicitor available and for the research back. Okay. Councilor O'Donnell, you wanted to...
Well, I think also the charter gives us a window to reconsider this if we wish. So postponing might be equivalent to never overriding the veto. I don't remember what the number of days is. It might be 40 days or something.
So if I would, I'm going to make a recommendation that it's postponed. It would be helpful to know that days, because then I would make a motion that it be done at a council meeting before before that deadline.
I actually have the charter here, and I'm kind of speaking out of turn. I hope I can just
respond to council. The question was directed at you. That's
okay. Since we received the letter of disapproval on October 9th. A lot of time has passed already, so we may have it. The window may have been passed already. Actually, it says, the city council shall enter the objection to the mayor on its records and not less than 10 days, nor more than 30 from the date of its return. So, in fact,
so tonight would be the
So last council meeting actually was too soon. Mm-hmm. Next council meeting would be too late. So we're in the sweet spot for fighting on this issue.
We're there.
Right.
We're really putting the charter through the paces as we initiate. Councilor Adams.
So I guess it doesn't matter now. I was wondering what the specific questions were for the solicitor, but I don't think we're going to have that information before us when we make our decision. But to me, it's important to note that there is nothing accompanying this saying that we don't have the authority to do this from the solicitor. And I really believe that if we didn't have the authority, the solicitor would have opined that we don't have the authority, as the solicitor frequently does when the solicitor believes that we've overstepped. But again, I read it as merely an opinion with no legal authority backing it up.
A couple things. One is I'll take responsibility for this. I mean, I sent a letter, which I would like to summarize to answer some of the questions about what was asked of the solicitor. I sent that to him yesterday morning. So, I mean, I should have sent it a few days before that, at least. So there's that. So I wouldn't take the absence of an opinion from the solicitor to mean an endorsement of anything by the council or a disapproval, either way. That's number one. I would also say that, again, I think that there's the broader issue to discuss. And then there's the particular ordinance in front of us, which, whether these spaces are put there administratively or legislatively, I don't think matters very much. But I do think we should have this larger discussion. So if I can paraphrase what I did ask the solicitor, it was it started by referencing what Councilor Adams referenced about the school committee. The charter is very clear about a division of property between the school committee and the rest of the city. It says that the school committee has, it has general charge essentially over all school buildings and grounds. So it's pretty clear that we couldn't regulate JFK's parking lot. I think it is less clear whether we can legislate about a parking lot connected to the senior center or any other municipal building. I'm not sure whether we have that authority. I would note that what the charter does say, that the distinctions the charter does say about the mayor's authority generally, to me, are all about function. It uses words like exercise, supervision, direction, administration, activities. And so I think that the separation is based on the mayor running the city. And if we legislate, we just have to make sure that we're not encroaching upon the mayor's ability to run the city, or in this case, administer the senior center. I would argue that creating parking rules in the parking lot doesn't do that. It doesn't prevent the mayor from running the Department of Senior Services. Now, if we started to say, we started to go in and say, well, what color do we want the drapes on the inside of the building, and we start getting into the interior, or if we started to do things inside City Hall, I think we would inevitably, you know, create difficulties for the mayor to run that agency or the city, and so we wouldn't be able to do that. But places where, you know, the general use of the property is primarily public, I think it stands to reason that the city council could legislate.
Councilor Murphy has not spoken yet. And Councilor Murphy?
I don't know that you can administratively create a handicapped parking space, because it has to be done by ordinance, which has to involve us. So I don't think there's a magic wand to make handicapped spaces.
Well, I know there's, I'm sorry.
There's actually a separate ordinance that creates handicapped spaces that for any business or for any other non-public way. I think that's the main distinction here, is that the council's authority over parking is generally in a public way. All the other parking spaces, handicapped parking spaces, in the Stop and Shop parking lot or any other, any other place, even in the school parking lot, those aren't voted on by the school committee. They were put up by the administration to comply with state law, which is controlled by the public access, access
right, board. State legislation.
Yeah, and there's an access
board. So many spaces per.
Exactly, and there's a separate code of your ordinances that actually spells that out, that if you have so many spaces, then you're required to have X number of handicapped parking spaces. Because clearly you don't have ordinances for all the handicapped parking spaces in the city.
Not on private property.
Yeah.
So relative to what Councilor O'Donnell said before, actually, and we're past due on this, is establishing an ordinance review committee, which the mayor has actually made his appointments, and I have to make my appointments so that we can start. And this, I think, will be an appropriate evening in which to discuss these, because I think there's a gray area that's not clearly defined that maybe would benefit from some better definition for, and this is where we bumped up against the division of powers and division of authorities and what and the definitions of the described therein. I don't know, I mean, we can try and work it out tonight, but I think it's a topic for a larger discussion on that committee.
How about a friendly reconsideration, because we're in the time frame to do that, understanding that if we do that, the solicitor is definitely going to weigh in on that and just do it. Hey, we really want an answer to this question, and we don't want the time frame to run out, so let's reconsider the ordinance, send it through the system, and the solicitor can decide whether we're out of order or not doing it.
Councilor,
I don't think it's really a larger discussion for us. I think there's a clear legal answer.
Yeah.
And we can't get that tonight. But I remember when we regulated the spots right behind City Hall a few years ago. We created ordinances and gave certain latitude and leeway for the mayor to assign certain spots to certain department heads. And I don't recall this conversation coming up at all.
That was before the charter.
I'm not sure if it was though, because it was about 2 years ago.
Was it two?
Councilor OFD.
OFD.
You and Daniels were still on the council. So,
and I vetoed, the only part of that I vetoed was the control. Well, I do think it's part of a larger, but there was an ordinance pertaining to parking of municipal vehicles. But there was an ordinance that was vetoed and upheld. But I do actually think that the lot behind there, that is a question mark. For example, at City Hall, if this is truly your authority, you could eliminate the mayor's parking spot and all the executive branch employees' parking spot. I'm just saying that you could do that. You could you could put up city council only parking at the senior center and say this is only for city councilors. So it's the, I guess that's what I'm trying to talk about, is that in the public ways is where most of the parking regulations pertain to, in the public ways. But while you can say that, yes, members of the public go and park at the senior center, it's not a public way. It's not the Armory Street parking lot. Whereas in the Armory Street parking lot, you've created a paid parking lot with time limits and an expense per hour. And so in order to exempt a parking spot from that regulation, you have to pass an ordinance actively to say there's a handicap spot there. So that's sort of the process.
Councilor Labarge is next, and then Councilor Shara.
So, Mayor, what I'm hearing from you is, like on Main Street, we have the meters, plus you have to have an ordinance for handicap parking because there's meters in that location. With the senior center, there's no meters at all. There's handicap parking there now. Was there an ordinance way back when they put in that handicap parking?
It's actually surprising to me that I know that they want to have additional handicaps. It is surprising to me that we didn't have them installed at the time of the. And I actually asked our. I asked the planning department about this. I don't know if Carolyn's still here, about how that happens. If you permit, when they do site plan review for a project, do they verify that the right number of parking spots have been installed? But it's not our jurisdiction. Like, we don't have enforcement authority over it. So it really is the access board in Boston that controls and, you know, that enforces the ADA. So individual stores, supermarkets, whatever, they put them up in compliance with state and other regulations. But we don't, it's not something we mandate or enforce. They're supposed to do it. And so I guess the analogy I'm making is that these lots, which are agency lots, they're not public, I mean, they're public lots, but they're, you know, we certainly wouldn't allow people to park there overnight. We don't allow them, you know, it's parking for the senior center. It's the same theory, I think. And again, I apologize the way this came forward. Part of this new reorganization, we're trying to have ordinances come to me before they come to you. And this was just one that got by me because of the way that it came
right.
forward.
Right, I mean, this because the request came from an executive agency,
I completely agree. But actually, the request came to the Transportation and Parking Commission,
which is an executive,
and asked about designating and designating handicap spaces. And I could fully see the Transportation and Parking Commission recommending you should add more parking spaces, and then Central Services would go out and add more parking spaces, not create an ordinance to do that. That's really, again, on the substance, I have no disagreement. It's more about the jurisdictional issue. And again, good laws make bad precedent. So we're talking about handicap spaces, but you could envision scenarios if indeed the council does have authority over executive branch property that, you know, the mayor's office could be relocated to a broom closet in the basement by a vote of the city council. And I don't know that could, really is a true reflection of the exercise of the various powers of our government.
Councilor Shero, you were up next.
We did vote to convert two parking spaces in the City Hall lot for the zip cars. Is that because it was a contract?
You actually gave me the authority to select two parking spaces, up to five parking spaces throughout the city. And enter into a contract with Zipcar. You didn't specify those spaces. So the ordinance actually allowed me to do that. When I brought it back to you, I said we've selected these two because they're previously were just 15-minute spots. And so that's how it was done. You may remember initially there was talk of doing it in the parking garage, which people were opposed to. So that was an order that allowed me the authority to negotiate a lease for up to five car sharing spaces, but it didn't designate any particular space. Okay. So actually, I just used the authority that you gave me to convert those spaces.
Councilor Dunn.
So at the fire station.
That's because I was entering to a lease. That's a little bit of a different thing. I just want to be clear. The reason I was before the council is because I was entering into a lease agreement,
that was
which requires a council vote. Yeah. Sorry about that.
Ready for my question. So at the fire station, there's two electric vehicle chargers, mm-hmm. charging stations, and yep. that's in our code of ordinances. Is that something you would suggest stripping out of the code of ordinances?
It's really, these are the kinds of questions that, again, we haven't really, you know, we've gone through the code of ordinances, we did the reorganization, we did the administrative code, and it seems like every time we go back through the ordinances, we still find things that, so that's a good question. Mm-hmm. That would be a good question.
I mean, because there is a gray area, and actually, just because the council has authority over public, mm-hmm. Public property generally, it doesn't mean we have plenary authority. It doesn't mean we can do whatever we want. There are clearly limits. I mean, I don't think it, I think anything we do that would interfere with you running the city, for example, the giant snowblower that we've said we can buy, I mean, we can't somehow hijack the snowblower and say we're going to use it for a different purpose. I mean, that's city property. We clearly can't do that because that interferes with you directly running the Department of Public Works. Mm-hmm. The same thing with putting you in the broom closet. As funny as that would be, we would never think of doing it because we like you too much, and also because I think it would totally interfere with you doing your job as mayor.
I guess, but
the parking lot is public. So,
but yeah. To me, it's still, it doesn't matter. You know, you can pick whatever example it is. It's the underlying principle of what you're trying to legislate. So that's just my that's my distinction between a public way and a non-public way. Uh-huh. So I realize this is like the strangest issue to have this conversation, but again, it's, I do think, for example, the City Hall lot, I think the Memorial Hall lot, I do think those are different, and those are things we'd want to take another look at. Again, we're still going to have we actually have to have handicap spaces to comply, not with council law,
federal
but
law.
State law. So it's a,
an ADA law. Councilor Adams.
We granted the mayor the authority to designate those Zipcar spots, and that's because we had the authority to grant it. And with respect to the spots that...
That's not really... that wasn't the authority you granted. You granted me the authority to enter into a lease for 5 parking spaces.
Because we had that authority. So
approve leases under Mass General Law. That's literally what the authority... That's the only reason I needed to come to you was because of that.
Please allow him to finish his sentence.
And then with the example that Councilor O'Donnell gave at the fire station, we had the authority to create those spots. For me, this isn't as that black and white. There's just no such thing as an executive agency lot. There just isn't one, and that's my belief. Did you discuss this with the solicitor?
Yes, I did. Yes, and he agrees with my approach. And again, this was one of these things that just came through. The Transportation and Parking Commission came to the city, to the city council, and it did not come to my attention until it literally came onto my desk. So
he agreed with that.
But actually, the charter does not, I'm following the process of the charter. Yeah.
Are you set? You all set? Councilor LaBarge, you have a question?
Mayor, so you did talk with our city solicitor.
That is correct.
And we apparently are waiting for, is that what I
unfortunately, I, so I spoke with him, and then he was awaiting some questions from counselors that came a little bit late, and then he was in court today.
Okay.
So that's part of the reason why he was not able to respond in time for tonight's meeting.
Thank you.
I'm already developing my appointments to the committee on ordinance review, actually based on the thrust of this debate. And we are to the issue. I think actually Councilor Murphy made a suggestion, and I don't know if you want to consider it, about reconsideration, which essentially buys us some time. I don't know if it buys us time that circumvents what the charter is, unless you want to vote to override the veto now.
I thought continuancing was the equivalent to allowing the veto.
He's offering reconsideration is what he's suggesting. So I don't know if that actually obviates the, I don't know if that pushes the envelope on the deadline. I'm not sure.
Well, I could.
Would you?
I don't know if I can withdraw my veto and to allow for reconsideration. I don't know, but it's already been passed by 2 readings.
Right.
I mean, again, I really, I don't want this to be a...
I think the point should be made. I think we all want clarity on this issue. And it is kind of actually, while it is, what prompts it is rather a weird and minutia. The fact is it speaks to the larger issue that we've always discussed, which is, and we knew this was going to happen with the charter change, that we were going to try and hack out how those divisions actually play out and what they mean. Councilor O'Donnell.
Yeah, I would just say, I mean, I sort of feel strongly about this, at least that it really needs to be looked at. And I guess I don't agree right off the bat that we don't have the authority to set parking spaces. But again, it's about this particular ordinance. And frankly, it would be a little strange if an ordinance that was suggested by the executive branch was sort of kind of commandeered by the council and then, you know, I mean, it's an idea that came from the mayor's office, the senior.
No doubt about it.
So I don't want to, you know, it's sort of out of deference to that I wouldn't really want to pursue a veto override just because the issue itself really needs to be discussed, which it does. And part of me would like to do that by overriding the veto. But I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, this did not originate from the council. So there's a commitment to discuss this in the committee on ordinances.
There are also other ordinances on the books which fall into the same category. So I would not begrudge you if you did override my veto at this point, and we'll have the larger discussion.
And it's to that point, I think the larger discussion for ordinance review, and it's a good discussion, it's a very good discussion. While this one might be putting people into comas right now if they're watching at home, but actually this is, as I said, this is the thrust of the challenges that we knew would come up, and it's good that we clear it up now. And so address, as opposed to address it at this level of specificity, I think, as you point out, I think the larger question is the more germane question. The existence of those handicapped spaces and where they're placed and how is probably not as germane, but the more important one is to get a final determination and define those, get brighter lines on these parameters is good for us to all understand. Councilor Spector.
So how soon will you make the appointment so that that committee can begin its work? Because the mayor's made...
I will work on that this week because I'm already late. The mayor has already sent his invitation. We already announced it. The election kind of got in the way, and I've sent out some invitations so far.
Just a follow-up question on that. So the plan would be that this committee would work, make various recommendations that would then come before this council or the next council, and have these more extensive conversations.
It's actually mandated by the charter.
Okay.
It's mandated by the charter that years beginning with zero or five that we have to do reviews.
So I'm going to, what I would support is to, I would not vote to override just because then it would probably make the papers more that the, on this particular issue, I think everybody agrees that the actual, the spaces will be done, whether it's through executive or the council. And I think we have a guarantee that we're going to discuss this in that committee, and it'll come back before the council.
That's right.
We can continue that thing. I just have a question for the mayor. Sure. You prefer.
Well, no, go ahead.
If the solicitor agreed with you, then he must think that our act is illegal. And if so, it wouldn't require a veto. It would be an illegality, and we shouldn't be at this point.
Well, I guess it defined,
I would just think if he thought it was illegal, he'd say this ordinance is
illegal. Illegality, you think the solicitor's looking out for, but I mean, there's been plenty of times where the council has, you know, there's always these issues that have arisen during this whole process, whether it's dates, meeting dates, deadline, charter deadlines for things, or even the deadline for the committee. I think we're going to have a hard time doing it in the year that ends with a five.
Right.
So, I mean, there's things like that.
Yeah. If I could clarify, I guess what I mean is, did the solicitor review it pursuant to our rules before it came to ordinance? Do we know?
I don't know. Did he review it and sign off as to form, or?
He did, yes.
Okay, so he signed off to form his legal character. So it would be tough for me to imagine he thinks it's illegal if he signed off to form in legal character, which is what he's required to do.
Yep.
So
well, that's why I would like to.
Mistakes were made, clearly.
I'd like to have him here to answer those questions, which would be the larger discussion itself.
Again,
Councilor Murphy and then Councilor O'Donnell.
Well, in this case, we have the assurance that the action item, the creation of the handicapped spaces, is going to happen. If it's under the mayor's authority, fine. They still happen. I, at this point, don't see the urgency for this. If the solicitor is going to ultimately weigh in on it, the action item is the spaces are going to occur. There's no item on the table other than to ask the solicitor, you approved it according to form, but then later agreed that we didn't have the jurisdiction to do it. You know, we'll work that out for us and tell us why this happened the way it did. But the bottom line is the spaces exist, it accomplishes the goal, and then we can work on the issue of, you know, how did it happen that way, and in the future, how are we going to deal with it in its own time?
I agree, and that's why I asked Council President for the assurance that it would be discussed and so both things will happen.
Any other questions, point? Councilor Adams.
I don't really know what the suggestion is. My hope would be that we vote on the reconsideration tonight.
Vote on what?
Taking the same vote on the reconsideration tonight. Voting yes or no on the same thing tonight.
Thank you.
Well, so any other discussion?
I would really like to vote for reconsideration. It seems like we're taking an ordinance that didn't come from the council, it came from the executive branch, and we sort of facilitated and shepherded it through. And if the view of the executive branch through the mayor is that they no longer want to do it, that's sort of out of deference to that, that I would,
Wait, Councilor Spector.
I'd say we go ahead and vote, and that could be registered as voting. Then you vote for it, you see it, which would be you could vote in deference to the executive. But we might as well go ahead and do the vote, and each person could express how they want to do this, whether they want to override or whether they don't want to override, and that will be an expression.
But that's the motion that's on the floor, and the motion.
Right, and I would.
That's okay. We just answered.
So I would suggest we call the question, and then each person could say how they want to proceed on this particular.
Call not subject to debate. Roll call, please. Yes.
This is a motion to override.
To reconsider or override.
Okay.
Reconsideration of the ordinance regarding parking spaces at the senior center.
So a yes would be to vote yes to override.
Or to a favor of the reconsideration and would thereby be an override of the veto.
It's as if it were before us for the first vote.
For the very first vote.
Just yes or no.
There's no discussion.
Okay.
We're done with discussion?
If
I may, I would also say if you do vote to override it, we have this ordinance review committee. We could always take it out at that point too. So, so that just occurred to me.
Yeah. Just muddying the waters slightly further. Take it away.
Councilor
Scherr.
No.
Councilor Spector.
No.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Kern.
No.
Councilor Dwight.
No.
Councilor LaBarge.
No.
Councilor Murphy.
No.
Councilor O'Donnell.
No.
The reconsideration fails. And I will appoint our members of the committee, whether they like it or not. our members will, and we will get to this. And then at least we have a part of the problem with the review committee was that it became so as you recall, it came so quickly on the heels of the actual establishment of the charter, we didn't really have much to, we thought there was much there to talk about. Now we clearly have something to talk about, so that's all to the good. Next up, we have the ordinance pertaining to glass to ensure the structures exempt from review minimally maintain the existing amount of glass on street-facing facades. I'm glad this wasn't reduced to an acronym. Mm-hmm. This is to refer to the committee on row.
Yes. Move to refer.
Second.
Why don't you take them as a group?
Second to refer. Any discussion on this? All those in favor of referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Next up, we have an ordinance for a complete streets policy. This is also to refer to Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances.
To refer.
Motion's made and seconded to refer. Any discussion on the referral? All the...
Can I just say that the documents and the city manager can have documents?
Yep. Are they both identical? Yeah. In Rao.
Yeah.
Rao will clear that.
Figure it out on Monday.
All right. Thank you, Rao.
Just in case anybody has any questions about those.
Thank you. Did we vote? We haven't voted on that. All those in favor for the referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? This is also to refer to the Committee on Rules, Orders, and Appointments and Ordinances. This is an ordinance regarding winter parking regulations.
Move to refer.
Second.
Second. Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And any opposed? Any abstentions? Getting down to it. This is an ordinance revising section 312-117, schedule six. What do we got here? This is a Roman numeral. This is 16 handicap parking spaces on Kai Street. This is to refer to the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances.
Move to refer.
Motion's made to refer. All those all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Last up, ordinance revising section 312-46, designation of parking spaces and refer to Committee on Rules, Orders, and Appointments and Ordinances.
Second.
Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? I have no updates. Are there any information?
Councilor Murphy, do you want to schedule now the ordinance? The ordinance meeting?
Oh, that's right, Councilor. Thank you.
We can now, you know, it's not an action. I was really people checking their calendar, so we can do it after we adjourn.
All right. No new business. I'll accept the motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Sure.
Aye. Thank you very much.
So we're not scheduled.